Today we're looking at 17.1 in the A level, but actually if you're a GCSE student you can still learn a lot of this. It fits in with topic 13 at GCSE level, so you can make some useful links and get some information from it there as well. Most of it students will already know. There's not a lot of uplift from GCSE, so I'm just going to go over the basics. So clearly we know that each of our cells contains 46 chromosomes. You took 23 from mum and you got 23 from dad. We know that. We know that when you lay them out, when you map them, you have them in pairs. So this one maybe came from mum and this one came from dad. Then you get another pair, one from mum, one from dad, and so on. So we've got 23 of those pairs. Now, the first thing to notice is that when they're laid out, they've got their matching because we match them in terms of length. But the other thing is that we start them in order of size. So your first pair of chromosomes are your largest ones, and then they get increasingly smaller until you get through to the 23rd pair, which are down here, and they're a much smaller length of DNA. They're a much smaller chromosome. Now, actually, when we look at the carrier graph, that is the picture that's organized when we lay all those chromosomes out, it never actually looks like this, like a straight strand, like a chromosome, one there and one there. It always looks like this. Now, this confused me for years because I didn't really know if this was one chromosome, why it had two strands like that. And what we need to remember is that normally the chromosomes in the nucleus of a cell are so spread out and unraveled that you can't actually see them. And the only time they become visible is when they start to shorten and they start to thicken just before cell division. Well, during that time, they're also duplicating themselves because it's cell division. They're going to split the cell. So they need to make an extra copy of each chromosome. So at this point, the reason when we see a chromosome like this, the DNA, the chromosome, has already been copied and that cell was about to split. But that's the only reason we're able to see them and they become visible like that. Forgetting now that they look like that, let's just look at a diagrammatic representation, assuming that they haven't copied themselves. And let's just assume that one chromosome looks like this, and one looks like this. This one's come from mum, perhaps. This one's come from dad. Now, the thing that I want to talk about is a word called homologous. They are homologous pairs of chromosomes. And what homo means is same. So the same one in the first pair came from mum, and the other one came from dad. They match up, they are the same. They are homologous pairs. Assuming that this is our first pair of chromosomes and they're yours, so it doesn't matter that they came from mum and it doesn't matter that it came from dad. But what we're looking at now is what we mean by genes and what we mean by alleles. So on each of this pair of homologous chromosomes, there is a position. So for example, this bit here of the chromosome might code for eye colour. And the corresponding bit on the other chromosome in exactly the same place will correspond and have the gene for eye colour. So this particular place on a chromosome, we call it the locus. That is where the gene sits, on that particular locus. And in the same species, it's in the same place, whether it's you, your brother, your sister, someone down the road, it's all in the same place. With the example of eye colour, one of the things that you've got to get right is the word gene and the word allele. So I like to think of it in a sentence. I think there's a gene for eye colour, and within the gene for eye colour, there are two different alleles, brown and blue. So keeping it simple, an allele is a type of a gene in its different forms. So when we're representing these different alleles, what we do is we give them a letter. Now, for example, for eye colour, I might say let B equal brown, and I might say, let small b equal blue. So this person may have the allele for brown eyes, and they may have the allele for blue eyes. Now that's confusing, because straight away you think, well, do they have brown eyes or do they have blue eyes? Well, the fact that these have got one's capital letter and one's a lowercase letter gives something away. What this actually means in terms of genetics is that the brown colour is dominant. That's where it's got the capital, the uppercase letter. And the blue colour is recessive. Now, what that actually means is they're not equal in strength, that in the presence of a dominant allele, the recessive allele is masked, so it is not shown up in the individual. So in this case, we would describe this person as heterozygous because they have different alleles. If this person had big B, little b, they'd have brown eyes, and we would call them homozygous. If they were small b, small b, they're homozygous, but we have to point out that they are recessive. So let me go over that again. Homozygous, recessive. Homozygous, but dominant. Heterozygous. So now what we're looking at is, if these are the genotypes, in other words, the type of gene that you have, what is physically expressed? So when we're talking about the physical expression of your genotypes, we call it the phenotype. So this person, because these genes are recessive, but because they haven't got a dominant one to mask, this person is going to have blue eyes. This one has only got the brown, it's dominant, but it doesn't mask, they've only got the brown. So they can only express, they'll have brown eye colour. And this person, they've got one of each, but because this is recessive, and because this one is dominant, this one is going to be masked, and this is the one that's going to be physically expressed. So this is, therefore, brown eyes. We've talked about dominant, we've talked about recessive, but there's also a situation where we can talk about co-dominant. And what that means is that there's more than one allele, but that the alleles actually have equal strength, if you like. They're equally expressed. But that can manifest itself in two different ways. So let's take the example of blood groups. If you remember, you've got your A, you've got your B, and their antigens for different blood groups. So if we just think about that for a moment, if that was antigen A, and then if you've got another one, and that's antigen B, so this person, its genotype could be simply AO. Those have phenotype A, or they could be AA, and they would have phenotype blood group A. On this example, it's exactly the same setup. They could be BO, which would give them the phenotype of blood group B, or they could be BB, and that would give them the phenotype of B. So that's really simple. So what happens when somebody is blood group AB? In that circumstance, you've got A expressed, but you've also got antigen B expressed, which therefore gives you blood group AB. Not one doesn't take priority over the other, they're both expressed. For example, it can manifest itself in a different way. So for example, in some kinds of flower petal colour, you might have a gene for white, you might have a gene for red. Now, rather than having some white petals and some red flowers, or some red petals, what we actually end up with is pink. So codominance can show itself in two different ways, showing both forms or just blending them so we get a new colour altogether.